Hello, this is John Kanellopoulos. I'd like to welcome you to our ambulatory surgery unit here in Athens, Greece, LaserVision Institute, and go through this quite interesting case. This lady is pseudophakic in her one eye and has, as you can see here, a significant cataract in her other eye. So time came to do the second eye, and it's her left eye. We're having immersion ultrasound measurements of the axial length to confirm the interferometry. We can see here on the optless wide field fundus view how cloudy the left eye is. Of course, all keratometric evaluations, we saw pentacam maps here, the anterior segment, Avanti OCT shows us thickness maps and the epithelial distribution. We are scouting for keratoconus everywhere in all of our patients. These are the Landstar measurements. The endothelial cell counts are good. Don't get tricked by the black spots. They're not guttata. They're just pigment because they're cutting cells in the middle. And this is the Tomei interferometry. We use it to double-check the Landstar measurements. Of course, evaluate the macula pre-op, just mild retinal membrane, but everything else looks good. Nothing worse than doing a good cataract procedure to reach a surprise of macular damage in a patient who has vision of 20, as we can see here, 70. And this is the IOL calculator for the Acrysof lens. Lens does not come out torque. We use toric lenses in 85% of our cases, even T2 toric lenses. And this is going to be an IQ lens. Now, remember, I like to orient my IQ lenses always horizontally in order to reduce negative dysphotopsias by the haptics being horizontally and extending temporally and obstructing some of the negative dysphotopsias. My main incision paracentesis using the keratome, but just for 1 millimeter, viscoat always. Doesn't look that the cataract is that significant from this view. Nice red reflex, but we all know that the proof is in the pudding. Continuous silvilinear capsular X's manually here. We went through many paths. This is my favorite, about 5.5 millimeter in diameter. And here's our signature phaco going in and emulsifying the lens. We're going to use a divide and conquer technique. And here we're seeing that this is a significant cataract. See how I'm very careful, not pushing and stressing the zonules. I'm going to use my second instrument as a means to stabilize the lens. I'm going to have a little bit of iris trapped in my paracentesis. Always keep our eyes through the whole picture. And again, we're up with energy at 60%. And we're rotating the lens now. Fortunately, the lens rotates well. And we're seeing here the corectopia as the iris is being trapped a little bit on the paracentesis rather. I'm going to sculpt a nice central groove and crack here and complete the crack. So now I have two hemimeridians, but we can see how large the lens is and how dense. One of the denser lenses of our routine, but it's not that rare in our routine here. Patients in Greece tend to do surgery pretty late. Unfortunately, colleagues evaluate patients in dark rooms. They have good visual acuity, maybe 20, 30, and never evaluate glare and how that can affect these patients. They can trip on a bad sidewalk or while walking down white stairs in a very sunny environment. My pupil is down, trapped a little bit in paracentesis, so a good time to use some epinephrine or adrenaline, if you like to call it that way. And we'll see how nicely the pupil is going to dilate just enough for us to have a better view. Again, second tube of viscoat. Very careful here since we're going to use quite a bit of energy. I'm hoping to be under 200 joules total. But with repeated filling of the chamber with viscoat, we end up with minimal endothelial cell damage. Usually the eyes are pristine the next day. We're down to the last quad. And I have reinflated the chamber with viscoat, my favorite viscoelastic, for the divide and conquer part of the procedure. We can all appreciate how dense the lens is. The reason I'm going through this case is I want you to pay particular attention at the end. I wanted to show all the nuclear removal, and here again the third tube of visco. I know it sounds like too much, but every patient is valuable for us. We will spare no expense, rather spare any effort to protect the endothelium. You can see that during the case how well the cornea is doing. I'm at the pupillary level now. And again, very careful not to go fishing for that piece that was behind my phaco tip. Rather use methocellulose here to advance it so I can safely go in and pick it up and finish my phaco emulsification. Very careful going in not to strip decimate's membrane. Last bits here, always my second instrument is underneath my phaco tip to avoid having the posterior capsule come upward. And now again, I'm going very carefully here and removing the cortex, and we see no problems in the capsule bag. The capsule axis is still nice and central. I'm using my split aspiration instrument through my paracentesis, keeping my irrigation main tool and the main incision. Very stable chamber here and capsule bag. Again, a 5 to 5.2 millimeter capsular axis. Everything looks perfect. Quite large lens, so slightly hyperopic eye. Non-toric. We're going to implant carefully the lens once filled the capsule bag with the methocellulose. So again, nothing really funny here, but this is the part, the most interesting part I want to share with you. This is my routine manipulation. I'm going to try and let the beautiful Acrysof material unfold. Always very elegant. And here I'm going to try and orient the lens horizontally and see that fold superior in our view, kind of an arc. Very, very dangerous folding of the capsule here. It tells me that the bulb of my haptic towards the left on the surgeon's view has grasped the capsule bag, and if I tease it more, I may tear it, or I may have some loose zonules in that particular region. So I'm going to remove the viscoelastic. I'm going to make sure that I have no vitreous present. There is obviously no capsule rent. If I had manipulated the lens more, I would have probably tore the capsule, and I may have done it in the past, I'm pretty sure, but fortunately I picked it up early enough. You may want to go back and look again at that particular moment where there was a significant fold in the capsule bag, just the superior to the surgeon's view, to the superior arc of the IOL. So here, everything looks fine. I'm going to hydrate my incisions to reestablish a watertight wound, both in the paracentesis seen here and previously in the main incision. And see that the lens still seems a little bit dislocated towards the right. This is the left eye, so it looks dislocated nasally. And again, I'm not going to push the issue here. I'm just going to rotate the lens clockwise to our view and release that area that was probably trapped by the bulb of the haptic. I'm playing with the lens a little bit. Everything seems to be fine. See how nicely now the lens is centering. So I released that warpage of the posterior capsule that happened on my haptic. I'm going to break my protocol. I'm going to leave this lens implanted vertically. Sacrifice some negative dysphotopsias for the first 2-3 months until the posterior capsule pacifies in order to save the day and not rip the posterior capsule. So I hope you found this presentation interesting. This is John Kanellopoulos signing out. Thanks so much for your attention.